So welcome everybody to the first lecture. And the intention is to give you the abstract framework of causal fermion systems. And I don't expect you to understand right away what the connection to physics is, because this is something we will then do in the next few days. So what I will give you here is just like the kind of the backbone, the mathematical backbone of the theory, and then we'll fill it with later with life afterwards. So what is a causal fermion system? Let me just begin with a general definition. So this is like 1-1-1 definition. And maybe I should also say that these numbers here on the blackboard always refer to the numbers in the book. I mean, there's like, you can download a draft of a book on the homepage, and the numbers here are the same as in the book so that you can easily look things up. Okay, so what is a causal fermion system? So we start with a Hilbert space, and we denote the scalar product like this with an index H. So we let this be a separable Hilbert space. And moreover, we are given a number n, just a natural number, 1, 2, 3, 4, whatever, called the spin dimension. And now we let F be a set of operators, namely this should be operators which are first of all linear and bounded, and it should be of finite rank, namely their rank should be at most 2n, should be symmetric. So a symmetric operator means that one can diagonalize this operator and one can count the eigenvalues. The eigenvalues are all real. And then we demand that A has at most n positive and at most n negative eigenvalues. Okay, so this is a subset of the linear operators. And finally, we let rho be a measure on curly F, measure just as we saw it in the introductory talk by Jan-Hendrik. By measure always mean like a positive measure. Or more specifically, one has a subset of sets of F, which are distinguished as the measurable sets, and to every measurable set we associate a non-negative number. Okay, and the resulting triple, so this means H, F, rho is called causal fermion system. Okay. Maybe just make a few remarks. First of all, the separability assumption on the Hilbert space. So this means we assume that the Hilbert space has an at most countable basis. This is more a technical assumption, which is not really needed. It's more a matter of convenience. Namely, later on when you work with bases, it's always better to assume that it's separable. And also, well, most or all the applications we have in mind, well, for these applications, it's fine to just work with separable Hilbert spaces. Exactly, it's always complex Hilbert space. Good question. You mean like where? Like so the symmetric just means self-adjoint operators. So this means that AU V is the same as U A V for all U V in H. Okay, so this is the general definition. And as I will explain later, say tomorrow or on Wednesday, so such a causal fermion system describes the space-time together with all the additional structures therein, so with wave functions and fields and so on. So, and now we need a criterion to decide which space-time is realizable in nature. I mean, like, what is a physical space-time? And to this end, one has to formulate some physical equations, say. And the way this is done here is that we impose that rho should be a minimizer of an action principle, of a variational principle, which we call the causal action principle. And let me now explain how this causal action principle is defined. So suppose we take two elements of curly F. Well, then X and Y are both linear operators having all these properties. And in particular, we can take the operator product. So X times Y, this is again a linear operator on our Hilbert space. And it has again rank at most 2n. Well, simply because each of the factors has rank at most 2n, and if you multiply operators, the rank cannot get larger. So this is again an operator of finite rank, but it will in general not be symmetric. Let's just check this. I mean, if I take the adjoint of x times y, this is the same as y star times x star. Since x and y are symmetric operators, this is the same as y times x. Well, but y times x is not the same as x times y in general, simply because we do not assume that the operators x and y commute. So they will not commute in general, and therefore, this x times y is a non-symmetric operator. So x times y is, in general, not symmetric. Okay, but it has finite rank, and finite rank means, I mean, similar to what we learned this morning in Jan-Hendrik's talk, so we can compute the eigenvalues, or more specifically, we can look at the characteristic polynomial, compute the zeros of the characteristic polynomial, and then there are at most 2n eigenvalues which are non-zero. I mean, all the other eigenvalues are zero anyway. And then we denote these 2n non-trivial eigenvalues. So let I denote them by lambda xy1 to lambda xy2n be the non-trivial eigenvalues of x times y, and to be more precise, counted with algebraic multiplicities. Okay, and by non-trivial, I do not mean that all these eigenvalues are non-zero. So it could be that, for example, this operator product x times y has rank 1. Then there's only one non-trivial eigenvalue. And then, for example, I set this lambda 1 xy equal to this non-zero eigenvalues, and all the others are set equal to 0. So non-trivial does not mean that all the lambda 1 to lambda 2n are non-zero. It just means that all the non-zero eigenvalues of the operator x times y appear among those 2n non-trivial eigenvalues. Okay. Now these are, in general, complex numbers. Well, I mean, if you have a symmetric operator, the eigenvalues are all real. But since this is a non-symmetric operator, the eigenvalues will in general be complex. So this is something to keep in mind. So we have now 2n complex numbers, and this all depends on the choice of the pair of the points x and y. Yes?
At most 2n,
yes. So this is what I meant. So it could well be that some of these eigenvalues are zero. Okay, now we form what we call the closed chain, the spectral weight and we denote it by just the absolute value of x times y. So this is defined by, we just take the absolute values of these eigenvalues and sum them up. And similarly, we can also take the spectral weight of xy squared. Well, it's defined in the same way. We just take the absolute value of these eigenvalues squared. Okay, and now we can already write down what the Lagrangian is. So we introduce the Lagrangian. L of xy, this is defined by the norm of xy, let us see again, always get confused here, yeah, xy squared, the spectral weight of x times y squared minus 1 over 2n times the spectral weight of x times y squared. So that's the Lagrangian. Well, and this is the mapping. I mean, if you look at this L, I mean, it depends on two arguments, x and y. This is a mapping from F cross F to the real numbers a priori. And now we can integrate this Lagrangian over x and y, and this is what the causal action is. S, so this is like the integral over f cross f of L of x comma y, and we integrate, so we take as the integration measure the measure in the definition of the causal fermion system. So here this measure rho is what we take. Maybe I should have mentioned we also call this measure the universal measure. So we integrate with respect to the universal measure. And now the causal action principle is to minimize this causal action under variations of the universal measure. Okay, minimize S under variations of rho under certain constraints. Under the following constraints, and then let me clean the blackboard first. So here the object to minimize really is like the measure. And I will also say soon, like in which class of measure. So I want to make this mathematically more precise. But let me first of all state the constraints. Well, the first constraint is the so-called volume constraint, which just says that the total volume, so which is the measure of the whole space, which you can also understand as the total volume, should be fixed, is kept fixed. The second constraint is the trace constraint, saying that if I take, I mean, x is a linear operator, which is like symmetric and of finite rank, so I can take the trace of this linear operator. This gives me like a real number, or it's a real valued function on curly f, and then I integrate this with respect to the measure rho. and this should be, is also kept fixed. And finally, there's so-called boundedness constraint. Which states that if I take x times y, the spectral weight squared, and integrate this over f cross f, that this should be bounded by some small or equal to some constant capital C. Okay, so of course, like here, there come additional constants which come up. So this capital C and the other constants. And so, and minimizing under these constraints, this is what the causal action principle is. You mean like this here? Well, this, I mean, this X is an operator of finite rank. So this is definitely well defined. Of course, integrating this over f, I mean, this will in general not be well defined. It depends a lot on the measure you consider. So we only consider measures for which this is finite, and then we keep this constant fixed. In fact, this is what I wanted to make more precise now. Sure. In fact, this is also what I want to explain now. I mean, because I mean, I wrote it down in a very general setting. I didn't say in which class of measures do I minimize. And this number here, is this just one, or could this be any other number? And this is, in fact, a little bit a tricky point, and therefore I want to explain this now in detail.
Is the spectral weight
No, in fact, I mean, that's a good point. I mean, this spectral weight is not a norm. For example, if you take like a nilpotent operator, then the eigenvalues are all trivial. So therefore, also the spectral weight is zero, but the operator is not zero. So it's not a norm. And also, I think you cannot express it in terms of just taking traces or whatever, some LP norms or anything like that. So it's really different. In fact, really minimize. I mean, we'll see soon that this Lagrangian is in fact non-negative. So therefore, if we integrate something non-negative, so therefore this action is always non-negative, and therefore it really makes sense to minimize here. Okay, but now let me make precise in which sense. Well, how is this well defined? What does this mean mathematically? And there are different cases which one can study. The simplest case is you assume that H is a finite dimensional Hilbert space, or just a linear algebra setting, if you wish, and also the total volume is finite. Well, in this case, just by rescaling, one can always assume that this total volume is equal to 1. Okay, then we have a probability measure. And in this case, one knows that minimizers exist. So this is like a paper from 2008 where the existence of minimizers is proven. So therefore, everything is like nice mathematically. And one also sees that all these constraints are needed in order to avoid trivial minimizers, in order to ensure that minimizers exist. So in this setting, everything is well defined. And now you might wonder, well, but finite dimensional Hilbert space is maybe not so interesting for doing physics. I mean, in quantum mechanics, Hilbert spaces are typically infinite dimensional. And so there's also the case, the dimension of H is infinite. And it turns out that in this case, also the total volume should be infinite. I mean, if this is infinite and the total volume is finite, it turns out that there are only trivial minimizers. And so basically, these are the only two cases which make mathematical sense. And here I would just say, like, so this makes mathematical sense. But there is no existence theory yet. In other words, this has not yet been studied in detail. No, there are always many minimizers. This is also something you see in typical examples or simplified examples, that there always, there's a whole class of minimizers. There are many. So uniqueness is not what to expect. Okay, so in this case, this makes mathematical sense, but there's no existence theory yet. And therefore, the way to proceed here, maybe also philosophically or whatever you want, is that one says, well, maybe this is the case we are really interested in. This is the physical case. But just this dimension is finite, but very large. And then one has to pass to a certain limit. And then in this limit, take a sequence of minimizers here, basically, and then study the asymptotic behavior as the dimension goes to infinity. So this is the picture behind it. So we only, I mean, even although later on we will also work with infinite dimensional cases, whenever we study the causal action principle, one should in principle go back to the finite dimensional setting and then take a suitable limit. Okay, maybe also I should have mentioned, like in this case here, minimizers exist in the class of normalized Borel measures. So the correct class of measures is really like Borel measures. And therefore, from now on, we will only restrict attention to Borel measures. By the norm to the norm topology. Okay. I mean, that's in fact a good point. Class of Borel measures. And with respect to the topology, of course, you're right. I mean, when I talk about the Borel measures, I should say what are the open sets. Topology induced by the operator norm, and which I write like this, and which in the introductory talks was denoted by this. So just I take the topology induced by the supremum norm. Okay, so this is kind of the mathematical setup. I mean, are there any questions so far? And you could say, okay, from the mathematical point of view, that's all there is to say. I mean, so this is like, this is what a causal fermion system is, and this is like the causal action principle. We have to minimize it. And whenever we have found a minimizer, this gives us space-time, which satisfies the physical equations. So this is like the general picture. Of course, now you might wonder, well, this is so abstract. I mean, how should there be, now what is the physics behind it? I mean, what is space-time? What are fields? What are wave functions? And it turns out that all these additional structures are in fact encoded in the causal fermion system. And this is something I want to explain. And in fact, it will take a while to explain all this in detail. So we proceed in several steps. And the first step is like space-time and the causal structure. Well, and the starting point is, so we just let H F rho be a causal fermion system. So how should we proceed now? And maybe just to give like give you an idea of what we can do. I mean, first of all, one should note that such a causal fermion system encodes a lot of information. So it's a lot of information stored in the causal fermion system, if you wish. For example, let's say information encoded. I mean, what could you do? I mean, I just want to show you that there you can form many different quantities. For example, you could take whatever you can take, the trace of x, and let's say the trace of x times y, and then you integrate this over d rho of x, d rho of y. And you can take any power here. And whenever you do this, you get a real number. So you get a lot of real numbers, which you can produce in this way. And well, you can also take two different things. I mean, you can, for example, for corresponding x, one can consider the eigenvalues and eigenspaces of all these different points of f, and then integrate those quantities again with respect to the universal measure and so on. So there are many different ways of forming real valued quantities. And this is what I mean by there's a lot of information encoded. Of course, it's not so clear what does this information mean and what does it have to do with space-time or with additional structures in space-time. And I will now give definitions which clarify this. And we will see later on that these definitions really agree with what we know from Minkowski space. I mean, I will now do something called space-time and causal structure, wave functions, and so on. And a priori, it's not so clear what does it have to do with whatever, with the wave function in Minkowski space. But we'll see later on that there is really like an agreement, a correspondence in a certain limiting case. Okay, so how do we define space-time? And we denote this by M. And this is just defined as the support of the measure rho. So it's a subset of curly F. Now, what is the support of a measure? So this is something we didn't have time this morning. So let me explain this. I mean, there are two ways of doing it. I mean, intuitively speaking, a support is the set of all points where the measure is non-zero. So one way of doing it is to say, okay, we take a point x. So we take all the point x with the properties that rho of u is strictly positive for any neighborhood, for any open neighborhood of x. So this is one way of doing it. Equivalently, one can also do it like this. We start from open sets of measure zero. So we take omega open, so always a subset of curly F open, with the property that rho of omega is equal to zero. So I take all the sets of measure zero. I take their union. Well, then the union of open sets is again an open set. And then I just take the complement. In other words, I take F minus this whole set. And it turns out that these definitions are equivalent. It's just like reformulations of each other. So in this way, we can distinguish a subset of curly F. So the picture is if you have like here curly F, which is again a subset of the linear operators, and also takes the corresponding topology, then the support of F will be a certain subset here. You could also have like discrete parts and so on. So this is like M defined as the support of rho. And maybe in the exercises we could make an example which shows you that the support of a measure can really distinguish like some geometric object. So this means in this way we can distinguish like a subset, and this subset can also have like a certain geometric structure. And also the way to think about it is that, the support of rho should typically be a very low dimensional subset. I mean, so this curly F, so this will be a very high dimensional object. I mean, if the dimension of the Hilbert space goes to infinity, the dimension gets larger and larger, but this support here should just be something which is, say, four dimensional. And we'll see this later in examples how this works. I mean, this is just for you so that you have like the correct picture in mind. Okay, so now how does it, what is now the causal structure? And the way it works is as follows. Now let's take two space-time points. So we take two points in M. Well, and just as before, I mean, we can consider the operator product x times y and compute the eigenvalues. Let's write it like this. So we can have lambda x, y, I goes from 1 to 2n be the non-trivial eigenvalues of this operator product x times y. And these are complex numbers, and this is why there are different cases. Namely, it could be that these eigenvalues are all real. In this case, we call the points time-like separated. Let's not write it like this. So the space-time points x and y are called, well, then we write here time-like, space-like, light-like. Separated if, and now we have here like different cases, so if the lambda x, y, I are all real and do not all have the same absolute value. Okay, then what does it mean space-like? Well, space-like means that they all have the absolute value. If, well, let's just write it in formula. So lambda x, y, I, absolute value is the same as the absolute value of lambda x, y, j for all I, j from 1 to 2n. And in all other cases, we call the points light-like separated. Otherwise. Okay, so this is just a definition. And I should say that, I mean, like in this space-like separated case, the eigenvalues will in general be complex. And if they are complex, they always form complex conjugate pairs. I mean, this is like comes from the general structure of, if you look at the eigenvalues of such operator products, suppose we write here the spectrum of x times y. So whenever lambda is an eigenvalue, then lambda bar is also an eigenvalue. So typically you have like such complex conjugate pairs, and then there may be also like points on the real axis. And in total, always counting with multiplicities, you have 2n such points. Okay, so this is just a definition, and we'll see later that this definition really makes physical sense, meaning that if you go to Minkowski space in a certain limiting case, this gives back the usual notion of causality, which we saw this morning. Yes. Exactly. So if that's the idea. I mean, if you vary the measure, then the support also changes. So this means then you change space-time, and at the same time, all the structures encoded in the causal Fermion system. So therefore, you change then the metric and the field and so on, everything at the same time. And then suppose now you have a minimizer, then this gives you like the causal structure of the resulting space-time, and then you can construct corresponding wave functions and so on. So this is like, this is the picture. Okay, now with this causal definition of the causal structure, I mean, there are a few things to check in order to make sure that this really makes sense. And let me just check a few well, it's more just remarks which show you, well, maybe there's something, maybe this is something reasonable to do. And the first observation is that, so this notion of causality is compatible with the Lagrangian. Why? Namely, as you suppose, x and y are space-like separated. Well, then the eigenvalues all have the same absolute value. Well, it turns out that the Lagrangian can be rewritten in terms of the eigenvalues. Let's say, writing the Lagrangian as, well, I mean, this L is defined as the spectral rate of xy squared minus 1 over 2n xy squared. Now we can write this as a sum over the absolute value of the eigenvalue squared, and this as the sum of the absolute value of the eigenvalues, the whole thing squared, multiply everything out. And it turns out that this Lagrangian can be written as the sum from ij equal 1 to 2n, and then just, let's see, there's a prefactor, 1 over 4n, 1 over 4n times lambda xyi minus lambda xyj absolute value squared. I mean, this is just an algebraic transformation you do. So the Lagrangian can also be written like this, and if you prefer this form of the Lagrangian, we could have started with this. We could just have taken this as the definition. And here you see, first of all, as I already mentioned before, this Lagrangian is always non-negative because we have like here a real number squared. And moreover, you see, if x and y are space-like separated, then the eigenvalues all have the same absolute value, and then this difference vanishes. So this is equal to zero if x and y are space-like separated. In other words, points which are space-like separated, they do not contribute to the causal action. And we'll see later, if we consider the corresponding order Lagrange equations, which are kind of the dynamical equations in space-time, again, the point of pairs x and y will not enter if the points are space-like separated. So therefore, this gives like a notion of causality in the sense that points with space-like separation do not interact with each other. So this gives a general notion of causality in the sense that points with space-like separation do not interact. Let me just put this in quotation mark. And this fact is also the reason for the name causal action principle. Well, and you can think of it, of this minimization process as follows. I mean, if two points are space-like separated, the Lagrangian vanishes, and this is the best you can do. So therefore, if you minimize the action, then one tries to arrange that as many pairs of points as possible have space-like separation. On the other hand, it's not possible that all pairs of points have space-like separations, and therefore there's like an interesting interplay when you minimize the action, and this is what gives rise to like non-trivial causal structures if you look at minimizing measures. Okay, so this is one observation. Now the next observation is like that this notion is symmetric in x and y. Well, I mean, like if x has time-like separation to y, then it should be, then y should also have time-like separation to x. I mean, all these notions should be symmetric if you interchange the roles of X and Y. And it turns out that this really is the case. But let me explain briefly how this goes. Well, I mean, you're right. I mean, you could also define this causal structure for any points in curly F. So, I mean, if you replace this here by curly F, then you could say, oh, well, I've introduced this causal structure on all of F. And then the minimizing measure distinguishes like a subset of F, which is then like this M, the space-time, and then we get an induced structure on M. And this is what we are interested in the end. If you wish, you can do it like that, yes. But I mean, but of course, I mean, the point is like the M depends heavily on the measure. And in the end, we only consider this causal structure on M, on the support of the measure. Okay, so the notion is symmetric. In X and Y, well, and this can be seen as follows. I mean, suppose we want to compute the eigenvalues of the operator X times Y. Then we need to consider corresponding minimal polynomial. We need to find a polynomial where this vanishes. And in fact, I mean, we know that this is an operator of finite rank. So using this procedure, which Jan-Hendrik explained before, we can just assume that this X times Y vanishes outside a finite dimensional subspace and just consider this finite dimensional subspace. Let me just write it down. So this can be represented as, or write this as U times, and then we have here something B zero times U to the power minus one, and U is unitary. So we can also represent it like this. And then computing the eigenvalues of X times Y can be done by just computing the characteristic polynomial of the matrix B and computing its zeros. Well, and then now what are the coefficients of the characteristic polynomial? They are all formed of symmetric, well, of these symmetric polynomials. In other words, you just need to know what is trace of XY to the power P. So if you know all these quantities for, well, p is equal to 1, 2, in fact, like 2n, so this determines the coefficients of the characteristic polynomials, determines the coefficients of the characteristic polynomial of p. And therefore, there, of course, the detailed formulas are somewhat complicated, but once you know all these traces, then you can compute the eigenvalues, at least in principle. Okay, but now the key observation is that this trace is like cyclic. So this is the same as trace of y times x to the power p. I mean, you just cyclically commute the factors inside the trace. And therefore, you see that x times y and y times x are isospectral. So therefore, x times y and y times x have the same spectrum. And also not only the same eigenvalues, but also the same multiplicities. And therefore, up to maybe a relabeling of the indices, the lambda I, so lambda xyi is equal to lambda yxi after suitable relabeling of the index I. Well, and therefore you see that the definitions here are invariant if you exchange the roles of x and y, And moreover, one sees that the Lagrangian is symmetric. So this means L of xy is in fact the same as L of yx. And this is kind of good to keep in mind. And you see also this, or this is one indication that this all this seems to make sense. Okay, I mean, are there questions so far? Well, I mean, you have to keep in mind, I mean, these operators, they should all be in curly F. So this should all be operators of finite rank, which have at most and positive, at most and negative eigenvalues. So that's the only restriction. And you can take a measure supported on any, you pick any such operators. You define, for example, like a sum of Dirac measures supported at these points, and then you can do this construction. Yes, consistent with the corresponding space time. And so in other words, like the, if you take any crazy, would you just take any points here, you define, construct any kind of measure, then these notions are well defined. But this does not necessarily mean that this is like a physically interesting or physically be reasonable example. So we will see later that for specific choices of universal measures, it really does make physical sense. And this is like a generalization thereof, but of course you can also construct very weird space-time. You can, could still call them space-time, but it's not so clear what it means physically. Well, but here, the idea is that this is the correct Lagrangian. Maybe, I mean, we'll see like at the, on Thursday, so that this Lagrangian really gives the Lagrangian of the standard model in a certain limiting case, and also gives like the Einstein-Hilbert action in a certain limiting case. So here there's just like this Lagrangian, and the hope is that this really is like the correct way to describe physics. And yeah, to me it's nice that there's only like this one Lagrangian and that's it. So there's no freedom to play around. And this is also something one can even prove. I mean, there's like a, well, in fact, like if you want like the Minkowski vacuum to be a minimizer of the Lagrangian, a stable minimizer, then this is the only choice. But I think this will be clearer when we consider the different limiting cases. Of course, this is a good question, but maybe then we can come back to this. Exactly, exactly. I mean, a priori, this is a completely different setting. Also, I mean, for example, what is also different, I mean, this Lagrangian depends on two points, a pair of points, not just on one point. So it's really like a different formulation, and we'll see, and this is also like the main goal of this week, that I will try to explain you how to get this limiting case where you see, okay, this Lagrangian effectively amounts to the standard model Lagrangian and the Einstein-Hilbert action and so on. Okay, so this maybe, let's see how much time we have. Okay, this looks good. So now let me just mention that there's also a notion of direction of time. I mean, right now we have like a distinction between time-like and space-like, but it's not clear what is the future and what is the past. Is there a way of distinguishing this? Direction of time. And in fact, there is a way of doing this. Namely, this works as follows. So let X be, again, a space-time point. Then the image of this operator X, I mean, this is an operator of finite rank. So this is an at most 2n-dimensional subspace of the Hilbert space. So this is a subspace of the Hilbert space of dimension at most 2n. And now we denote the orthogonal projection onto this subspace by pi x. So let pi x, so this is then the operator from h to x of h, be the orthogonal projection in the Hilbert space onto this subspace. Okay, and then we can form the following functional, C of xy. This is defined by minus I times the trace of, let's see, what was it again, y times x times pi y pi x minus x times y times pi x times pi y. Okay, and this C is then a mapping from M cross M to, in fact, the real numbers. Because if you take like the adjoint or if you take like the complex conjugate and then you play around with these factors, then you see that this is, in fact, real valued. Okay, and what is also nice is that if you exchange the two arguments, then this flips the sign. I mean, you see, like, if you exchange x and y, then just this term becomes this term and vice versa, and due to this minus sign, this gives a sign flip. And therefore, you can just use this function to define what the future or the past is by just saying, well, if this function is positive, I call it the future, and if it's negative, then I call it the past. I think we need more water here. Okay, we just say x, or let's say y lies in the future, respectively past of x, if, well, the c of x comma y is positive or negative. Okay, and I should say, of course, like whether I take the positive phi and negative phi or vice versa, this is like a matter of convention. In other words, there is not really a way of distinguishing the future from the past, but what we can do is if we have like fixed our convention here, then we can say what the future is globally, I mean, for any pair of points. Okay, so this gives us a time direction, and I should make a few remarks, namely, this time notion of time direction is not necessarily transitive. I mean, usually, like if you have a point, for example, you have here x, so if I plot like here points in Minkowski space, suppose y lies in the future of x and z lies in the future of y, then z also lies in the future of x. This is how it's usually with notions of lies in the future of. And in fact, like this idea of this having this transitive kind of partial ordering, if you wish, on space-time points, I mean, this is like made precise if you look at this causal set approach. Let me just write in contrast to causal sets. So here, this notion of future, lying in the future of it in general, not transitive. So this means that, for example, there could be time-like curves or something microscopic time-like curves, something closed time-like curves, something like that is are possible here. Okay. Well, in fact, I mean, the way it is later on is like if you take this continuum limit so that the space-time goes over to as Lorentzian manifold or Minkowski space, then this notion of lies in the future of agrees with the usual notion of lies in the future of, and then you get transitivity back. Therefore, generally speaking, you get transitivity back if you have like a not too large space-time region, which is macroscopic. Then on a macroscopic scale, things will be transitive. They do not need to be transitive on the, say, large scale, because the Lorentzian manifold can also have closed time-like curves, so there's nothing to expect here. But also there's a possibility that on the microscopic level, say Planck scale or whatever you think about it, there could be some tiny closed time-like curves. And this is something one, well, also if you look at simple examples, I mean, you can't exclude this possibility. Okay, so I think now the next.
Can there be closed time-like curves on large scales?
Yes, sure. I mean, not in Minkowski space, but if you start, I mean, tomorrow I'll show you how, starting from Minkowski space, you can construct a corresponding causal fermion system. And this construction also works on a Lorentzian manifold. And if you take a Lorentzian manifold which is not globally hyperbolic, so that's a closed time-like curve, then the corresponding notion lies in the future of will also not be transitive on the large scale. So this is something which is conceivable. Okay, so maybe the next section is like the kernel of the fermionic projector. In fact, we saw this kernel already this morning, just like a distribution, the Fourier integral, the Fourier transform of the lower mass shell. And in fact, later on, this kernel of the fermionic projector will just be the same thing as what we introduce now. But now it's much more general, and you won't see the connection right away. Now, what is the idea? In fact, you can understand this construction just by thinking about the causal action. I mean, suppose you want to compute the causal action, or let's say the Lagrangian, then we need to compute the eigenvalues of the closed chain, which we had like over there on the blackboard. And so one has to look at these traces of powers of the operator, and since these x and y's are operators on an infinite dimensional Hilbert space, or at least a very high dimensional space, this is not so easy to compute. It's not so good to get a hand on it. And for this reason, it's better to restrict attention to a smaller dimensional subspace on which, such that on the complement, everything vanishes. I mean, this is like an idea we already used here. I mean, basically, like here, we had like a finite dimensional subspace, and on the orthogonal complement, everything was trivial, and therefore we could restrict attention just to this small dimensional subspace. And this is the same idea which leads us to this kernel of the fermionic projector, and this goes as follows. So again, let X be a space-time point, and now we denote the image of this operator, which we just had on the previous blackboard. We denote this now by Sx and refer to it as the spin space. It's just a different name. We'll see later that this name really makes sense. Okay. And now we introduce this P of xy as pi x times y, pi x times y restricted to sy. So this is a mapping from sy. Then we go to the Hilbert space, and then we project down to sx. So this is a mapping from sy to sx. So this is a mapping from one spin space to the other spin space. Okay, well, what's good about this? Suppose we form the product p of x comma y times p of y comma x. This is what we also denote by a subscript xy and call it the closed chain. Okay, then we can also write this out in more detail. So this is pxy restricted to sy times pyx restricted to sx. In any case, so this is a mapping from sx to itself. It's like an endomorphism from this at most two-n-dimensional subspace of the Hilbert space to itself. And we can simplify this formula. Namely, this projection to y, we can just leave it out because the operator y itself also projects to its image. And similarly, we can also write it like this, pi x times y times x restricted to sx. Okay, so this is like the closed chain. And now what happens if we take powers of this guy? Suppose we take axy squared. Let's just compute this. I mean, then we have like here pi x times yx restricted to sx times pi x yx restricted to sx. And again, we can leave out this intermediate factor of pi. And then we just get y times x squared restricted to sx times pi x, and so on. I mean, the same formula holds if we take like the pth power of this, then we just get pi x times y x to the power p restricted to sx. Okay, this is like a simple computation, and now if you take the trace of the whole object, of the trace of this operator, and usually I denote the trace over a subspace of the Hilbert space by a capital trace. Well, this is just, well, just a convention I'm using so that you can kind of distinguish if I take the trace over the whole Hilbert space or just over a subspace. So here it's like this operator is only defined on the subspace Sx, and therefore we can only take the trace on the subspace, of course. So now form this capital trace over Sx of Axy to the power p. And later on, I will often omit this index Sx. Well, then this is just the trace of pi x, yx to the power p restricted to Sx. And now we can kind of cyclically commute the factors and use the fact that x vanishes identically on the orthogonal complement of Sx. Because Sx is defined as the image of the operator x, then this turns out to be the same as, and now this is the trace over the whole Hilbert space, maybe for clarity I write it like this, of y times x to the p. Okay, but before we saw that knowing all these traces, we can compute the eigenvalues of y times x. Or from this formula, we can deduce that the closed chain has the same eigenvalues as y times x. Or maybe I should have been more precise, has the same non-trivial eigenvalues. because I mean this acts on a higher dimensional space, so there will be many additional zero eigenvalues coming up. So the conclusion is that AXY and Y times X have the same non-trivial eigenvalues. Well, and these non-trivial eigenvalues is what we denoted by lambda xy1 to lambda xy2n. And we saw before, this is symmetric in x and y, so instead of writing x times y, I could also write y times x, yx makes no difference. So the good news is that now these 2n non-trivial eigenvalues can be computed just by computing the eigenvalues of this operator AXY, which just acts on a 2n dimensional subspace of the Hilbert space. In other words, if we later on n will be equal to 2, if you describe Dirac spinners just as an example, then this can be represented by a 4x4 matrix. So we just need to compute the eigenvalues of such a 4x4 matrix. Okay, and then and this is, well, to me, I mean, this is like this most natural way to understand why this kernel of the fermionic projector, how it's called, is useful. Simply because it can be used to compute the Lagrangian. Okay. The P of XY. Well, in fact, the kernel of the fermionic projector, because it has these two arguments, X and Y, similar to the distribution this morning. Okay, now there's one more thing which is also comes up naturally in this context. Namely, we would like this kernel to be symmetric. What does this mean? I mean, this P of XY is an operator from SY to SX. Well, maybe, hopefully, there's some kind of notion of adjoint here. So if we take like the adjoint of P of XY, well, this should then be a mapping from SX to SY. This should just go the other way around. Well, and hopefully, or what we would like to have is that P of X comma Y star is the same as P of Y comma X. Which means this is like the usual relation one would have for an integral kernel which ensures that the corresponding operator is symmetric. Exactly, that's the point. I mean, right now we haven't introduced an inner product yet on the spin space. So the question is, can one introduce an inner product in such a way that this holds? And so, and maybe then, well, the simplest choice would just be to say, well, SX, this is a subset of the Hilbert space. Well, why not just take the Hilbert space scalar product and restrict it to the subspace? But in fact, if you do this, then this relation does not hold. So therefore, it's better to introduce a different inner product on the spin space, and which I will write down now. So the correct choice is the following. So we introduce like this inner product, so like just mapping from SX cross SX, and we write an X here, and these are the same kind of brackets as this morning for the spin scalar product. This goes to complex numbers. This will then be called a spin scalar product. And the idea is to take the operator X itself as the signature operator. So we write here psi, X, phi, and then here just the Hilbert space scalar product, and just this is just a convention, we put a minus sign here. So this is like the definition. And this is an indefinite inner product. of signature, let's just call it signature PQ, where P and Q are both small or equal to N. I mean, kind of the signature of this inner product is determined by the number of positive and negative eigenvalues of this operator X here. So X has at most N positive and at most N negative eigenvalues, and consequently, this inner product has a signature PQ, where PQ is small or equal to N. Okay, and as I said, so this is just like a definition, and you might ask, well, why take this definition? And the reason is that it makes the kernel of the fermionic projector symmetric. Let's just verify this. Well, the minus sign is just convention. It makes no difference. I mean, this is because later on, if you consider these Dirac C structures, then it's better to have a minus sign here in order to get agreement to the usual definition of the spin scalar product we had this morning. Well, but I mean, you could also put a plus sign here, would maybe be nicer at this point. But I mean, this is really, there's nothing to it. So let's just verify that this kernel of the fermionic projector really is symmetric with respect to this, to the spin scalar product. Let's just write down where such an expectation value. We have to be a bit careful now. So this is like the inner product at the point x. So psi is an element of Sx, and phi is an element of Sy, so that everything makes sense. Okay, now let's just write down what, let's insert what P of Xy was. So this was just pi x times y, just definition of the kernel of the fermionic projector. And now we write down what the spin scalar product is. So this gives minus psi x pi x y phi. And this is now the Hilbert space scalar product. And then here we can again omit the factor pi x, because x already projects onto that. So we just have minus psi x y phi. Now we can bring the factors x and y to the other side, because just taking their adjoint, and since they are both symmetric operators, we just need to flip their order. So we get y times x psi phi. And this can be written in a somewhat more fancy way. Well, y pi y x psi phi with a minus sign. And then we can bring the y again to the other side, and we write this as the spin scalar product. So then we have here, sorry, then I should write, of course, these brackets, and then we have here pi y x psi phi. And this is the spin scalar product at the point y. Well, and now this here, this is just the kernel of the fermionic projector. So we just get P of y comma x psi phi. Okay, and then now we see that really the adjoint of P of xy is P of yx. Just what we wanted. Also, the reason why we plug in this factor, this x here, is just to arrange that we get a symmetric kernel. Okay, I want to point this out because, if I don't explain it so in detail, then it might seem that these definitions are kind of artificial, or they are, well, that they don't come up naturally, and that maybe one could also define this in a different way and so on. But I mean, look at it in this way. This is kind of the natural objects to introduce if you just want to analyze the Lagrangian. If you want to compute the Lagrangian in a convenient way, then it's good to work with this fermionic kernel of the fermionic projector. And it's also convenient to introduce these spin spaces and to introduce on those spin spaces an indefinite inner product. And of course, as we will see tomorrow, I mean, this indefinite inner product will then just correspond to the inner product on Dirac spinners, which we had this morning. Okay, let me see how much time do we have. So we started at, when is the break? I mean, how much time do we have left? Okay, let's say 15 minutes or something like that. Okay, that sounds good. Then we need a break anyway. And also that's just fine to introduce now wave functions. Okay, what are wave functions? Well, now right now at every point x, we have a corresponding spin space as x, which is endowed with this indefinite inner product with the spin scalar product. I mean, this is what we have now. To every space-time point, we have kind of attached or associated a corresponding spin space. So this is a bit similar to a fiber bundle, say. I mean, if the space here would be a manifold, then this would correspond to, this could be made into a topological vector bundle. Well, but that's not kind of the point of interest. Now, what would correspond to a wave function? Well, and usually this is then a section of the bundle, or in a less technical language, to every space-time point, we want to associate a vector in the corresponding spin space. So therefore, what we do is we just say psi, a mapping from M to H, with psi of x should be an element of Sx is a wave function. So this is what is called a wave function. Okay. And now let me also mention, what does it mean continuous? Well, I mean, of course, this is more like a mathematical issue and not of central importance here, but still let me explain how to do this. I mean, the nice thing is that this psi maps to a Hilbert space, and the Hilbert space here has like a topological structure and so on. So therefore, there's a natural notion by just saying, well, this mapping should be continuous, and that's how we define continuity of the wave function. But it turns out that this is not a good way of doing it. And the reason is that it's better to work with the spin scalar product, and the spin scalar product involves this factor of x. And therefore, thinking of continuity, one should better write a factor x to the 1/2 and associate it to phi, and a factor x to the 1/2 associated to the psi. And this is, in fact, what one does. So let me make this precise. I mean, so the psi is called continuous. If the mapping, well, let's just write it like this. If let's just write it is continuous at x, if, and let's write it down with epsilon on delta, if for every epsilon bigger than zero, there is a neighborhood u of x in M such that, and then we just take the square root of the absolute value of x times psi of x minus the absolute value of the square root of the absolute value of y times psi of y, and now the Hilbert space norm of this vector is smaller or equal to epsilon for all y in the neighborhood u. Okay, and here the absolute value, what does it mean? So this is just the absolute value of the operator. I mean, if you diagonalize the x, and it has real eigenvalues, then you just take the absolute values of all of the eigenvalues, and this is the absolute value of the operator, and then you can take the square root, similar to what we had this morning. Okay, so this is like a, this is, to me, seems to be the correct notion. And then the continuous wave functions, I just write them like this. So this is the space of continuous wave functions. Continuous wave functions. Okay. In fact, yes. I mean, like, if you, I mean, this M is like a topological space, and then this SM here, you can introduce it as a topological vector bundle by introducing charts and then whatever, looking or how did that, how does everything transform under changes of charts and so on.
But it's not
automation to exactly. In fact, that's a good point. I just forgot something. I mean, if you assume, I mean, in fact, I mean, here the dimension of the SX is not fixed. It could jump from point to point. But if we assume that X is regular, I mean, this is like also a definition which we will see later. I mean, X in M is called regular if SX has the maximal possible dimension, which is 2n. So if this spin space has the maximal dimension, and then if you assume that every point is regular, then all these spin spaces have the same dimension, and then this gives you the structure of a topological vector bundle. So that's how it goes. By the way, it's good that you mentioned these topological structures, because then I can omit it later on. I just wanted to mention it briefly anyway, so let's just do it now. I mean, all these more topological questions, they are worked out in a paper together with Nikki Kamran, called like spinners on singular spaces and the topology of causal fermion systems, where, for example, we make this structure of topological vector bundle and the topological, how is it called, topological spin structure and so on, we make this precise.
The dimension,
well, if it's maximal, then by continuity it's also maximal in a small neighborhood. But it could always, I mean, if it's not maximal, then it could jump up. Okay, there's one more important notion before we go to the coffee break, namely if the notion of a physical wave function. I mean, right now we just have like the space of all sections of all, well, this is like a big space, all possible functions from M to X, which to every point associate a vector in the corresponding spin space. And this is not what we call a physical wave function. By physical wave functions, we mean those wave functions which are kind of realized by our system. And what we mean by this is the following. Suppose we take a vector of our Hilbert space and we take a point X in space-time, then we can just project the vector u onto the spin space at x. And this gives me a vector in Sx. And I denote this by psi capital U of x. And then what is this psi capital U? Well, this is a mapping from M to, well, S, or let's just write it like this. To X, I associate a vector in the corresponding spin space. Let me just do X. To X, I associate the vector pi XU, which is in SX. So in other words, this gives me a specific wave function. So this psi u, it turns out that it is also continuous in the above sense. So this gives you like a vector in C0 of m, sm. In other words, so the point is that to every vector in the Hilbert space, you can uniquely associate a corresponding wave function, which is like a function depending on the space-time point. And to every space-time point, you associate a vector in the corresponding spin space. And this really corresponds then to the wave functions of the occupied states, if you wish, of the physical system. Okay, and then there's just some additional notation. It's also good to introduce capital Psi, which is now a mapping from H to C0 of M, SM, maybe just to a vector U, we associate the corresponding physical wave function Psi of U. And I should have said, I mean, so this here, this is called like the physical wave function associated to U. Physical wave function of the Hilbert space vector. And this Psi, this is called the, what is it again called? Wave evaluation operator, exactly. And you can also then evaluate this at a specific space-time point. So if we take Psi of x, this is then a mapping from the Hilbert space to Sx. Well, just to U, we associate Psi upper U of x. Okay, and then there are a few more kind of identities, namely like this P of xy can in fact be written as the psi of x times psi of y star with a minus sign. And an the operator x is equal to minus psi of x star times psi of x. And this is in fact lemma 1.1.3. Okay, and of course, if you wish, we can also prove it. But maybe let's now go for the coffee break, and then if you like, we can do this afterwards. Okay, thanks a lot.